Everyone, a very warm welcome to all of you in my live teaching learning session. My name is Riya Pramanik. I teach you BPSC 131. The subject is Introduction to Political Theory. Today we will be going to learn about Unit 8, that is gender. Gender is a very big concept, and to understand gender we need to know it in detail. So let's see what we will be going to cover in today's lecture. The first thing is, what is gender? We will be knowing about gender in detail. Then comes gender and politics. We will be talking that why we are learning about gender or knowing about gender in politics, how it is related to politics. Next comes gender equality as a goal. The fourth thing which we will be learning about is that why gender equality is necessary. We often heard about concepts like gender equality. Then we will be knowing in this today's lecture that why it is necessary for gender equality in a society. The fifth thing which we will be learning today is gender issues and trends. So we should always remember that to know about gender, it is very important to know about patriarchy as well. So in this today's lecture, we will be also talking about patriarchy, theories of origin of patriarchy, then comes the gender concepts and theories and waves of feminism. So all these things I will be covering in today's lecture, which is all related to gender. And for gender to be understood in a proper manner, we all need to know about all these things properly. So let's move forward and let's start with what is gender. So we often heard the word gender, but many times we just only think about that it is only about women. But the word gender is being used sociologically or as a conceptual category. So it is considered to be a conceptual category. In its new incarnation, gender refers to the socio-cultural definition of man and women. So this sentence is very important, because gender, whatever we understand by gender, is the socio-cultural definition of man and women. So not biological, but a sociological, the society decides, the culture decides the definition of men and women. So societies distinguish men and women and assign them social roles. So for example, we live in a society where we have been assigned certain roles. For example, men are assigned role of going out. They are assigned a role to earn money to for their families, whereas women are considered to be the part of the household. She should be taking care of the household chores. She should take care of the children, the husband, the family. So these roles are assigned by society. So society distinguishes between men and women and assigns them social roles. So the distinction between sex and gender was introduced to deal with the general tendency to attribute women's subordination to their anatomy. So for example, we often refer sex and gender equal, like we use interchangeably, but the feminists, theorists, they talk about there is a distinction between sex and gender. So the sex is the biological distinction between male and female, but the gender is the societal. They are made by societies. So there is a difference between biological distinction and sociological distinction. And we often say that gender or sex we talk about or distinguish because of the anatomy of a person. So gender refers to the attribute of women's subordination to their anatomy. So all the social and cultural packaging that is done for boys and girls from birth onwards is gendering. So to understand this sentence, we should I should give you an example. Like since childhood, the baby girls are given kitchen sets to play with. So we don't give kitchen sets to boys, baby boys, but to baby girls. So this is gendering. From the time of birth since the childhood, we assign them certain roles and they used to play with those kitchen sets, and later on in life they understand that it is their duty to handle the kitchen, whereas boys are given to play with cars, guns and other things, which ensures or which assures them that they are made for driving cars and play with guns, so they are about security. So all these things are packaging, and these are called gendering since childhood. So the distinction between a girl and boys is started by its own family in the childhood itself. So according to Anne Oakley, gender is a matter of culture. It refers to the social classification of men and women into masculine and feminine. So there is a distinction or classification in masculinity and femininity. To understand it better, masculinity refers to the machoism, heroism, strength, strongness, and valor, whereas feminine attributes considers to be our caring attitude, loving attitude, very polite. So these are some kinds of classification which we talk about. So according to Anne Oakley, gender is a matter of culture. It is not biological and it is not scientific, but it is a matter of culture, and it refers to the social classification of men and women into masculine and feminine. So let's move ahead. Gender is deeply embedded in every aspect of society, in our institutions, in public spaces, in art, clothing, and movement. So we can see that gender is everywhere. Because also the world is comprises of men, women and other genders. But most of the population, like for example, more than 50% or around 50% of the population is women. And that's why it's very important to understand the concept of gender. So the concept of gender needs to be understood clearly as a cross-cutting socio-cultural variable, such as race, class, age, ethnic group, etc. So it is present in every socio-cultural variable. So where, for example, if we are talking about a race, there will be women and men in both race, in class, age, ethnic group. So it is everywhere. It is all around. And it is cross-cutting socio-cultural variable. Gendered roles are learned through socialization processes. They are not fixed, but are changeable. So to understand this sentence, we should take an example. In earlier times, we used to see that women were, given only household chores. They were not allowed to go outside. In many societies, it used to happen. But with time, we can see that how women are going outside. They are working outside, they are moving around, but these changes or gendered roles are not fixed but are changeable from time to time. The concept of gender is not interchangeable with women. So we should not understand this, that gender is equal to women. No, it is not interchangeable to women. Gender refers to both women and men. So in gender, it is not necessary that we are talking about only women, but it is about both women and men and the relation between them. So gender is the relation between men and women. Gender inequalities stem from relations of power and authority, class, caste hierarchies, and socio-cultural traditions, customs and norms. So we should also understand that why there are inequalities between these genders, because of power and authority. So the first thing is, the power is acquired by a certain category of people and the other one are dependent on it or dominated by them. So gender equality stems from the relation of power and authority, class, caste hierarchies, and socio-cultural traditions, customs, and norms. So let's move ahead. Next comes is gender and politics. So we should know that why and how gender is important for politics. So equality between men and women has become the dominant ideal within the mainstream political discourse. So in politics, it is very important and it became a dominant ideal that there should be equality between men and women. Being human beings, there should not be any kind of discrimination based on gender and other also like caste, class and hierarchies. But we are talking about gender in specific. So we should understand that in politics, the dominant ideal is that there should be equality between both the genders, men and women. Men and women should naturally have the same rights and no one should be excluded from political life. So in political life, what is nowadays what we learn about politics and all that, it is for all encompassing gender, caste, religion and everything. So men and women should naturally have the same rights. There should not be any kind of discrimination. And to understand this, let's talk about Aristotle's or the Greek city-states, which we have learned in our past lectures. So we have learned that in Greek city-states back then in ancient time, women were excluded from political life. Only men were part of politics, and slaves and women were not allowed to take part in politics. So nowadays, with democracy and with modernity, we have learned and we have accepted that men and women should naturally have the same rights and no one should be excluded from political life. Both the practice and the study of politics have long been notoriously masculine endeavors. So as we talked about Athens and Greek city-states, other Greek city-states, we learned that at that point of time, politics was always being a masculine endeavor and feminines or women were not allowed to take part in it. And it is believed that women are not capable to take political decisions. And that was very much stereotypical thing and stereotypical arguments. But we have seen that in politics, it is always seen that it is a domain of males. So many commentators have argued that politics has historically been the most explicitly masculine human activity of all. So apart from all other things, apart from different subjects we talk about, but in politics, we have seen that it was explicitly masculine human activity of all. So women were always sidelined, always marginalized by male members of the society who thought that women can't take political decision and can't take part in decision making. Women have by and large been excluded from traditional political activity and discouraged from defining their activities at political. So women were not allowed to be a part of it and they were excluded from the traditional political activity. So it was believed that they are incapable. They are not made to be a part of politics and it is only the male members of the society who can take part in politics because it was believed that they have reason, they have rationality, which women lacks. So it was earlier thinking, the thinkers and the society used to think like that. Now let's talk about gender equality as a goal. So gender equity denotes an element of interpretation of social justice, usually based on tradition, custom, religion, or culture, which is most often to the detriment of women. So there is a huge need to establish social justice and gender equity on traditions, customs, religion, and culture, because it has been seen that here in these kinds of in culture, in religion and all, women have been treated discriminatingly. So it is very necessary to provide equality to women. So gender equality means that the rights, responsibilities, and opportunities of individuals will not depend on whether they are born male or female. So whether a person is being born as a male or female, there should not be any kind of rights, responsibilities, or opportunities taken away from them because they are born as a female individual. So gender equality refers to that the rights, responsibilities, and opportunities should be equal to both male and female, irrespective of their gender or sex. So equality does not mean the same as promotion of gender equality does not mean that women and men will become the same. So here we should know that it doesn't mean that women and men will become same or they are same as like that, but there should not be any kind of social norms attached because of their particular gender. So equality between women and men has both quantitative and qualitative aspect. So let's talk about quantitative aspect. It refers to the desire to achieve equitable representation of women, which will be increasing the balance and parity. So what does quantitative aspect means? That means there should be, women should be given representation in politics, in society, and every other institution, so that there should be a kind of balance and parity. Whereas qualitative aspect refers to achieving equitable influence on establishing development priorities and outcomes for women and men. So this is the distinction between the quantitative aspect and the qualitative aspect. So equality involves ensuring that the perceptions, interests, needs, and priorities of women and men, which can be very different because of differing roles and responsibilities of women and men, will be given equal weight in planning and decision making. So the involvement, the participation will be equal between men and women in decision making and policy making. So next, move forward to why gender equality is necessary. We should know that why it is necessary to provide equality among genders. So equality between women and men, equal rights, opportunities, and responsibilities is a matter of human rights and social justice. So in my previous lecture, we talked about human rights. So being a human, all persons should be given some kind of rights to develop themselves. They should be given equal opportunities and will be given equal responsibilities so that there should be social justice around. So it is very important that equality between men and women should prevail in a society because all of them are human beings and they need to develop their own self. And for that, rights, opportunities, and responsibilities are very necessary. So greater equality, greater quality between women and men is also a precondition and effective indicator for sustainable people-centered development. The perceptions, interests, needs, and priorities of both women and men must be taken into consideration not only as a matter of social justice, but because they are necessary to enrich development processes. So as we have already talked about it, that we should know their interests, their needs, what are their priorities, so that they can enrich development process among themselves. So it is very necessary to develop both men and women as a personality because both of them are human beings. So inequality in terms of violence against women. So if we are talking about equality, we should also know that we are talking about inequalities and what kind of inequalities used to happen between these two genders. So inequalities in terms of violence against women, women political participation, representation in decision-making structures are lagging behind. So we have often heard about violence against women like domestic violence, rape, and all other crimes related to women, molestations and all. They're all examples of inequality between male and female and genders, men and women. So there should not be violence against women. Also, women's political participation is quite low. For example, in India, it is only one time that a woman become a prime minister, that is Indira Gandhi. Whereas in a society and a country like America, which is also considered to be one of the largest democracy in the world, never have their president in a woman. So they never elected a woman as their president. So we can see that the political participation was also very low, and with time it is increasing, but in a very slow pace. So the political participation of women is very necessary, because if they come to power, they will know what they want, what are the needs of a woman, and they can address those needs and those priorities. So there is also representation and decision making is also lagging behind, because all the decision makers, mostly all the decision makers in the world, not only in any country but most of the countries, it is seen that it is only the men who take decision, who take political decisions regarding policies and all other decisions. So it is very necessary for women to move ahead. They should be given opportunities to come forward, and then they should be taking part in decision making procedures. Also, there are many discriminatory economic opportunities. We can see that in many jobs, women and men are paid different salaries. So it is very important to consider women's work also same as like men. So apart from this, we also heard about trafficking and sex trade, which are a very grievous crime against women, and these are all the inequalities which prevail in a society. So let's move forward to gender issues and trends. So inequalities in political power. The first issue is inequalities in political power, and they talk about to access, there should be women's access to decision making and representation. So it is seen that women are underrepresented throughout the world. So throughout the world where there is democracy or autocratic rule, or it is a Western or Eastern part of the world, but still we can see that the condition of women are almost same. So women are underrepresented throughout the world, and there is a need to understand gender differences in power within formal decision-making structures, such as governments, community councils, and policy-making institutions. Further, given the underrepresentation of women and the low visibility of women's perspectives, the fact that women often have different priorities, needs, and interests than men is often not apparent. As we already discussed this point, let's talk about this, that many times we can see that because men are making policies, so many times they don't understand what are the needs, what are the priorities, and what are the women's perspective towards a law, toward a policy, or toward a program. So it is very necessary that women should be given proper representation so that they can take forward the problems addressed by women in day-to-day lives, what are their needs, interests, and what are their priorities, which often go unnoticed because all the policy makers are mostly men. So national, regional, or sub-regional priorities, or even the specific needs and priorities of a community, are often defined without meaningful inputs from women. So we can see that many decisions, big decisions, whether it is a national, regional, or at sub-regional priority, there the decision is taken without proper and without meaningful inputs from women. So this can be a reason why women are excluded, and women are not taken care or not taken care in that sense, but their ideas, their wants often go unnoticed because they are underrepresented, and there is no women to take that forward and to make it a policy or a rule. So next, move forward to inequalities within households, which often we see that we often neglect these inequalities, but it exists in every household. I can say that mostly in households it exists. There should be maybe few exceptions, but in a society, in whole world, we can see that there are inequalities within households, and inequalities in negotiating and decision making potential and access to resources have been documented within households. So women, because they are a part of household, they used to take care of household, they are the caring parent of a child, but there is a huge distinction between the access of a men and women on resources. So their women are very less accessible to resources, and they are discriminated over there, and there are inequalities between men and women. So that investigation of differences and inequalities at the household level is relevant to an understanding of a range of key issues. So there are many issues which we should take care, and there are many issues which often go unnoticed within the household. Let's move forward to differences in legal status and entitlements. So despite constitutions and international instruments which proclaim in equal rights for women and men, as we all know that Indian constitutions also provide equality between men and women, there is no distinction between them, but there are many instances in which equal rights to personal status, security, land, inheritance and employment opportunities are denied to women by law and practice. So many times it can be seen, or we often heard in newspapers and news, is that many times women are not allowed to take up a job just because of their reproductive capabilities. And it is seen that in few years, if she is a married woman, she will be planning her family, and in that case the person or the company she is working with will be in loss because of her. Why? Because she will not be able to give 100% to the company just because of her maternity or household responsibilities. So in that sense, we can see that there are many opportunities which are denied to women just because of their household chores and their reproductive power. So action to secure women's rights is not just a concern of a small group of women activists, but rather the responsibility of the international community as a whole. So irrespective of given legal status and entitlements, equal rights, but we can see that many times they are lagging behind, even though they have all the rights and entitlements. So it is not about gender among occupation. So we can see that women are given different jobs than men. So many times we can see that the soft works or the work which require low level of labor or labor power, so all these jobs are given to women, whereas the jobs which need strength are given to men. So all these things are discriminatory in nature. Women are also more likely than men to be low-paid jobs and non-standard work, such as part-time jobs, temporary jobs, or home-based jobs. So it is often seen that they are paid low wages as compared to men. So let's talk about the discriminatory attitudes. Gender inequalities are not only economic, but are also reflected in other ways that are difficult to measure and change. So we should not only think that it is only about economic inequalities between gender, but it is everywhere. So ideas about appropriate behavior, independence and aptitudes are often grounded in gender stereotypes and vary for women and men. So many times we can see that people used to talk that women can't drive a car. So it's a stereotypical thinking which says that women are not able to drive a car. But this is, the thinking is now changing, and more women are given opportunities which were earlier male dominated arenas. So let's move forward and talk about patriarchy. And to know patriarchy, it is very important to understand it through different theories. And patriarchy is very much important to understand gender. So, what is patriarchy? Patriarchy is the systematic societal structures that institutionalize male physical, social, and economic power over women. So, it is believed that the patriarchy means that it is the male physical, social, and economic power are more than women, and so they used to discriminate or dominate women. So, structures work to the benefit of men by constraining women's life choices and chances. So the patriarchy or patriarchal things or mindset is that women should be constrained from many choices and chances which will ultimately benefit the men. So the roots of patriarchy are often located in women's reproductive role and sexual violence, interwoven with processes of capitalist exploitation. So we can say that because women have a different kind of capacity to reproduce an offspring, and this is the thing which is considered to be the root cause of patriarchy, which emerges from that, and they locate that it is women whose reproductive role, and through that they used to violate their sexual arenas, and it is also interwoven with processes of capitalist exploitation. The main sites of patriarchal operation have been identified as housework, paid work, state, culture, sexuality, and violence. So it is often seen that to violate someone's sexuality, like raping someone or doing crime against a woman, they used to, or patriarchal mindset used to, is that women should be keep themselves within the household, and the public life is only for men, and they should not go outside, and if they are going outside, they should be punished. And in that punishment, what does the patriarchal mindset do? They used to go for sexual violence, which is a heinous crime. So the behaviors that discriminate, so let's understand patriarchy better. So it is the behavior that discriminate against women because of their gender are seen as patriarchal practices. So if someone is discriminating against a woman just because of her gender, that means they or he or she is having a patriarchal mindset. It should be understand very clearly that it is not always that men is patriarchal in nature. We can often see that it is women also who have patriarchal nature, and it is women who themselves restricts other women to do certain things, and all these characters and all these practices should be considered as patriarchal, even though she herself is a woman. So it is a mindset which can be found not only on men but also in women. So for example, occupational segregation, exclusion, and unequal pay. So all these things are patriarchal in nature. So the concept of patriarchy has been drawn into gender and development theorizing. Feminists who explain gender inequality in terms of patriarchy often reject male bias societal structures and practices and propose greater female autonomy or even separatism as a strategy. So the feminist who talks about equality between gender, so for them patriarchy is often the male bias societal structure, which is often male biased and which is against female getting equal rights, equal opportunities and responsibilities. And the feminists used to reject these thinkings or reject this male bias societal structure and practice, and they wanted to have greater female autonomy or even separatism as a strategy. So this entails a trade-off between women's autonomy and men's responsibility for their wives and children. So the thinking that it is the role of a man to provide security to his women of the household. So these thinkings are challenged by feminists because they used to believe that women can take care of themselves on their own and they don't need a male member of the family to provide security to her. So a rigid and universal concept of patriarchy denies women space for resistance and strategies for change. So let's move forward to theories of origin of patriarchy. So from where patriarchy originated, we should know this. So to understand this, we will be looking about three views or three theories of patriarchy. The first one is traditionalist view, the second is radical feminist view, and the third one is socialist view. So let's move forward with traditional view. Traditionalists opine that patriarchy is biologically determined. So according to traditionalists, they find that patriarchy is biologically determined because men and women are born different, and are consequently assigned different roles and tasks. So because men and women are born different, they were given different reproductive roles. So that's why from there onwards, the patriarchy arises. And as a consequence of this, they are given and they are defined or assigned different roles and tasks to carry forward. So since their biological functions are distinct, men and women must naturally have social roles and tasks. So according to traditionalists, they feel that because both men and women have different biological function, so naturally their roles should be also different and they should be distinct tasks to perform in a family or in a society. So according to traditionalists, since women produce children, their chief goal in life is to become mothers. And their chief goal in life is to become mothers and their chief task, childbearing and child rearing. So for traditionalists, they believe that because the chief work of a woman is to produce a child, so they should nurture the child, they should rear the child, they should take all the responsibilities of that child and the child's growing years. She should spend all the time in nurturing that child. So this thinking is often criticized by feminists because it is believed that the goal of a woman should not always be a becoming a mother. She have many other things to do, many other things to achieve in life. So these thinking are often challenged. The traditionalist theory of male supremacy has been challenged by many since there is no historical and scientific evidence of such an explanation. So the critics argue that this theory that male should be the supreme gender or women should be the subordinated by them is not historically or scientific evidence are there. So this is not accepted by the critics of traditionalist theory. So it is now recognized that patriarchy is man-made and historical processes have created it. So what critics argue that this thinking, this mindset is man-made, made by the men of the society and all the historical processes have created it. So history played a very important part in creating this ideology about this patriarchy. So let's move forward to radical feminist view. According to radical feminist, patriarchy preceded private property. The original and the basic contradiction they believe is between sexes and not between classes. So for radical feminists, they consider all women to be a class and not believe that patriarchy is natural. So they are also against traditional view of patriarchy. Traditional view of patriarchy used to talk about that patriarchy is natural because of the biological distinction between men and women. But radical feminists go against it and they say that they don't believe that patriarchy is natural and they consider that all the women forms a class among themselves. So according to some radical feminists, there are two systems of social classes. They talked about some radical feminists. The first one is the economic class system, which is based on relations of production. So relations of production, we have already talked about in previous lectures about it briefly. So it is about who is producing, who have the resources to produce, who owns the labor, who owns the capital. This is about that. So they say that the economic class system, which is based on relations of production, considered to be one social class. The other is the sex class system, which is based on relations of reproduction. So the first one is relations of production. The second one is to be the relations of reproduction. The concept of patriarchy refers to this second class of system of classes, to the rule of women by men based upon men's ownership and control of women's reproductive capacities. Consequently, women have become physically and psychologically dependent on men. So, what radical feminist argues is that male used to own or male tries to control the women's reproductive capacities. So how they do it? Restricting women to go outside in the night so that they can, there is a possibility that they will be sexually abused. So at these kind of things, women, what men do? they try to control women of their family so that they can control their reproductive capacities. Also, the decisions regarding a birth of a child is many times is seen is taken by the men and their family members and not by the women. Many times it used to happen, but we can't say that it's universal or we can't generalize it because there are many exceptions. But we can see that many times all the decisions regarding the reproductive capacities of a woman, the decisions is used to taken by the men and the family members. So consequently, what happens is that the women become physically and psychologically dependent on men. And this is the reason why women are dominated and why there are inequalities. Because it is believed that it is men who can provide security to a woman. And for a woman to be a good woman, she should believe in the men of the family members or male members of the family. And she should obey their rules so that they can provide them security in return. So all these things make a woman become physically and psychologically very much dependent on the male members of the family. Next comes to the socialist view. The socialist feminist combine both Marxist and the radical feminist position. So this is a mixture of both Marxist point of view and radical feminist point of view. So for them, patriarchy from them is not universal or unchanging. So for them, it is not universal and unchanging. They view the struggle between women and men as changing historically with the changes in the mode of production. So as the modes of production changed with time, with history, so they also see that the struggle between women and men also changes in history. So according to them, patriarchy is related to the economic system, to the relation of production, but it is not casually related. So according to them, it is the economic system which patriarchy is related to, and several other forces influence patriarchy such as ideology. So they also say that ideology plays a very important and influential role in shaping patriarchy. So just as patriarchy is not a consequence only of the development of private property, so it will not disappear when private property is abolished. So socialist believes that because patriarchy is not a result of the development of private property, so we can't say that if private property is abolished, patriarchy will also vanish. So they challenge this idea. So they look at both the relations of production and the relations of reproduction in their analysis. So let's move forward. Gender concepts and theories. So let's talk about feminist theory. What feminist theory means and what they talk about. So the feminist theory aims to understand gender inequality and focuses on gender politics, power relations, and sexuality. So what they used to understand inequality among the gender between men and women, and they used to focus on politics, gender politics, and how power plays an important role between these two genders and how sexuality is also important to understand. So feminist theory focuses on the promotion of women's rights and interests. So what are their main objective is to promote for the rights and interest of the women. So they also talks about various themes, and they also explores various themes, including discrimination, stereotyping, objectification, especially sexual objectification, oppression, and patriarchy. So these are few themes in which feminist theory used to talk or used to explore among themselves. So feminism supports social equality of men and women and is against sexism and patriarchy. So feminist theory, what do they tell? They want social equality between men and women. So many times it is believed that feminists are against men, but no, this is not the case. Feminists or the feminist theory talks about the equality between men and women. They are not against men, but they want equality among the men and women. They want the rights and the privileges given to men should be given to women as well. So we should also understand this, that feminist theory is not against men, but they talk about equality. So feminism involves political and sociological theories and philosophies concerned with issues of gender differences, as well as a movement that advocates gender equality for women and campaigns for women's rights and interests. So for the feminists, or the feminism involves the development of a women through rights, through giving them rights, opportunities, to know their interests, to know what they want, their needs, their priorities. So they don't want these gender differences. They want equality among men and women in the society. So the term feminism and feminist did not gain widespread use until the 1970s. So we can say that it is in the 1970s decade when these concepts like feminism or feminist theory emerged. And before that, there was not so much widespread use of these kinds of words. So the first feminism sign were seen in 1840s America for protesting of suffering of women and African root American people. So the first sign of feminism could be seen in America in the year 1840s. At the end of these processes, they won voting rights in 1920, but there is still defectiveness in gender equality in society. So even though women were given voting rights in America in the 1920s and many Western countries, but there were many inequalities which used to happen because of the gender distinction. So the feminists focus mainly on five subjects. There are many subjects, but mainly they focus on five topics. The first is working for increasing equality in society. So their first and foremost want or focus is to provide equality in society, making large area for choices of people in society. The third is destroying the gender stratification. So they focus on the topic that why there should be gender stratification, why there should be discrimination or distinction of roles, social roles, responsibilities, just because of gender. So they also wanted to finish the sexual violence, because it is through sexual violence that the patriarchy will also grow more deeply in a society. So sexual violence should be not there, and they encourage sexual freedom of a woman. So these are the wants or major areas where the feminists used to focus. Let's talk about the three waves of feminism. So we can see the waves. Through waves, we used to mean that how with time the feminism arose, how they emerged with time. So the first wave, we can see that the first wave used to emerge in the 19th and the early 20th century. This was the time. And they refers mainly to women's suffrage movements. So for the first wave of feminism, in the first wave, they used to talk about equal right of voting for women, because women were not allowed to take part in decision making and policy making. So the early feminists, they wanted women's involvement in politics, and they wanted equal voting rights. So mainly concerned with women's right to vote. So the first wave was about this. Next come to the second wave, which emerged in the 1960s and 1970s. So the second wave refers to the ideas and actions associated with the women's liberation movement beginning in the 1960s. And during this second wave, they used to campaign for legal and social rights for women. So the change from the right to vote to now becomes legal and social rights for women. Let's talk about third wave, which emerged from 1990s to present. They refers to the continuation of and a reaction to the perceived failures of the second wave of feminism. For third wave, they used to say that the second wave used to fail. Why? Because properly women were not given legal and social rights yet. So feminist activists have campaigned for women's legal rights, like right to contract, property rights, voting rights, women right to bodily integrity and autonomy, for abortion rights. So feminists used to talk about all these rights should be given to the women, like they should be the person who decide whether they should go for abortion and not, and for reproductive rights, including the access to contraception and quality prenatal care. Apart from this, they want protection of women and girls from domestic violence, sexual harassment and rape. Also, there should be workplace rights, including maternity leave and equal pay, which is a part of a human being, and being a woman, there should be some kinds of rights provided to them. And they are also against misogyny, the discriminatory attitude against women. Also, they are against other forms of gender-specific discrimination against women. So let's, the last part of our lecture, let's come to liberal feminism. So according to liberal feminism, it asserts the equality of men and women through political and legal reform. So what they talk about, they want that there should be political and legal reform which can provide greater equality between men and women. So the liberal feminism is an individualistic form of feminism which focuses on women's ability to show and maintain their equality through their own actions and choices. So according to liberal feminism, they consider a woman as an individual, a separate individual, and their the ability to show and maintain their equality through their own actions. So they believe that women should be taking their decisions on their own, and they should be they should take their actions and they should make their choices on their own without any kind of pressure and influence. So the liberal feminism used the personal interaction between men and women as the place from which to transform society. So according to them, to transform a society, to provide and to make an equal society, the personal interaction between men and women is very important, because from that point of time, we can say that the changes should be visible. So according to them, all women are capable of asserting their ability to achieve equality. Therefore, it is possible for change to happen without altering the structure of society. So liberal feminists believe that each and every woman are capable enough to assert their ability or to achieve equality, and they should be given chance to do that. And if they are given that much of chance, then it is possible for change to happen in the society even without altering the structure of society. So the last point of liberal feminism talks about the issues addressed by them are reproductive and abortion rights, sexual harassment, voting, education, equal pay for equal work, which is often targeted by many feminist groups, because it is seen that many women, and in many sectors, women are not paid equal to their male counterparts. Although they do the same kind of job for same or equal hours, but they are paid less as compared to the men, which is very discriminatory in nature. So they talks about equal pay for equal work and affordable childcare and healthcare, etc. So these are all about gender. We have learned about gender in detail today, what were the theories, how patriarchy emerged, and how gender equality is very necessary for a society to achieve, because we know that the half of the population are women, and if we discriminate among them, so it is very difficult for a human being to develop themselves. So in today's lecture, we have learned gender in detail. We understood how gender is very important in politics, and how women should be given chance to take decision, to make policies, because they know their priorities, their needs better than men. So if women are given chance to, take decision or take part in decision making, participate in policy making, the result will be much more greater and better than before. So gender is a very important topic in this subject, Introduction to Political Theory, which is BPSC 131. So we should know about it, and it is very important to understand. So in next part of my lecture, I will be moving forward to two different units. That is Unit 9, which talks about citizenship, and Unit 10, which talks about civil society and state. So we have learned briefly about state in our first part of the lecture, but in this unit we will be knowing it much more deeply and properly. So also the citizenship is very important to understand, because we know that we are citizen of a country, but there are many other categories which should be understood in this unit. So in our next lecture we will be moving forward with these two units, and today we completed gender, which is a very important part, which was unit 8. So let's move ahead with gender in our next part. So okay, thank you, namaskar.